Bluetooth audio devices are all the rage these days. But did you know there were wireless speakers and headphones over 30 years ago? Of course, Bluetooth didn't exist back then, so they had to use different technologies to transmit the audio wirelessly, one of which you can see in this DAC catalog from 1990. They called it the Wireless TV Marriage Saver. It used a beam of infrared light to transmit the audio from your TV or stereo system to a handheld receiver, which would then be connected to a pair of headphones. But just like infrared remote controls, it pretty much required a direct visual line of sight between the transmitter and receiver, and was limited to a range of about 20 feet. So a better method, which did not suffer from those limitations, was to use radio frequencies to transmit the audio. This became possible in 1989, when the FCC allocated a band of frequencies from 902 to 928 MHz for license-free use by consumer electronics. The most popular use of this 900 MHz band is by cordless telephones, but it has also been used by things like wireless intercom systems, wireless microphones, and older forms of wireless computer networking. And as you can see here, by wireless headphone and speaker entertainment systems. As you can tell by how tattered the image of the dog is, this is definitely not a new product. Just how old is it? It's from 1993, and it was made by Rekaton, a popular brand of inexpensive audio and video products owned by the Audiovox company.
Rekaton wireless speakers at Nobody Beats the Wiz. Totally new RF technology that'll take your sound wherever you want it. Just attach our transmitter to your audio or video system and get full, rich stereo sound. Upstairs, downstairs, even outside. And with Rekaton wireless headphones, you'll enjoy a freedom and privacy you've never known. Rekaton wireless speakers and headphones at Nobody Beats the Wiz. It doesn't get any easier than this.
And 900 MHz wireless speakers and headphones were on the market for quite a while, because here's a Crutchfield catalog from 2002, and it lists a range of them from brands like Advent and Sony. The fancier models had the receiver built into the headphones, and the transmitter doubled as the docking base for recharging them. While this more economical setup I have here uses a separate receiver, which runs on ordinary AA batteries, and if you want to be pedantic, it's not truly wireless, because you still have the wire going from the receiver to the headphones or speakers. These claim to have a range of 150 feet or more through walls and floors in and around your home, and they claim to have brilliant sound that matches virtually any audio or video component for a true-to-life, high-fidelity performance. And one advantage of having this separate receiver is that you don't need to use these cheap speakers or headphones it comes with. It'll work with any ordinary pair of headphones or powered speakers. And you audiophiles who get all up in arms about people defeating the purpose of vinyl by listening to it through Bluetooth because they're taking what is supposed to be a purely analog format, digitizing it and compressing it, should be thrilled, because these 900 MHz RF wireless speakers and headphones are 100% analog. Although in reality that was not such an advantage, because they were prone to causing interference to cordless telephones, and as you got near the edge of the signal range, you would start to hear static in the audio. So let's see how well this system works, or should I say, if it works, because it is about 30 years old. And just because something is in the original box does not necessarily mean it has never been used. It could be missing parts, it could be broken, or somebody could have left old batteries in it. You never know. Okay, those are the speakers. Got some paperwork here. And then this should be the transmitter and receiver. And headphones. Of course, they have styrofoam residue on the wire because it's been sitting in the box for so long. And here's the receiver and some wires and the transmitter. Some more wires which are pretty much fused to the styrofoam and the AC adapter. Okay, I do have all the necessary components, and it does appear to be totally unused with no old batteries left in it. So let's put some new batteries in it and see if it works. I tried out the little speakers and headphones that came with this portable CD player, and honestly, neither of them sound quite as bad as I expected. The speakers don't get very loud. That was turned all the way up both on these volume controls, on the speakers themselves, and on the CD player. But compared to a lot of these cheap little battery-powered speakers that were around in the early 90s, they don't sound that bad. You definitely want to have the bass boost button turned on. And one nice touch is that they have automatic power on and off. If you leave it with no audio playing, they automatically turn off, as you just saw. And if I turn up the volume on the CD player again, they automatically turn on again. So that way you won't run down your batteries. Here's the transmitter, and one odd thing is that there's something stuck in one of the RCA jacks. I don't know where that happened. Maybe at the factory, when they were testing it, they plugged in some cables, and when they unplugged it, it left part of the connector in, and they just didn't bother to remove it. Or if somebody who purchased this had that happen, so, okay, that wasn't too hard to just pull out that broken off tip of an RCA plug, so hopefully there'll be no harm done. And I can see this plastic film has never been peeled off. I don't know if at this stage it'll be able to come off in one piece, but we'll try. Okay, there it goes. And strangely, it runs on 18 volts DC. It says charge, but I don't think there's any batteries in this, so you need to run it on an AC adapter. You get a volume level adjustment for the input, your left and right RCA line level audio inputs, and a frequency adjustment. Because like I said, this is sharing frequencies with other devices like cordless telephones. So if there's something nearby using one of those frequencies and it's causing interference, you could turn this to try to get away from that and find a clear frequency to transmit on. On the front of the transmitter is this red LED, and the manual says to adjust your input level until it begins to flicker occasionally. But if it's on constantly, that means you're overmodulating and the audio will be distorted, and then you should turn it down. And the manual also explained this charger output is for recharging optional battery-powered headphones, but we didn't get those with this, we just got the cheap version. And here's that 18 volt DC, 150 milliamp power supply to power the transmitter, and it also has some protective film on it, which has never been removed, and unfortunately, I don't think this is going to come off in one piece, but I'll try. Okay, there it goes. I thought maybe this was causing that yellowing, but I guess it's supposed to be gold. I switched to a period-correct 1994 Sony Discman because that new portable CD player I was using before didn't have a high enough output level to cause the red LED to come on, but this one does. It's flickering occasionally, just like it should be. Now here's the receiver. It has a belt clip, and it runs on three AA batteries, and it's about the same size as a radio-only Walkman. And just like a portable radio, it has an on-off switch, a 3.5mm headphone jack, a stereo indicator light, a volume control, and a tuning dial. Now I'll plug in the speakers and turn it on and adjust the tuning. Stereo indicator came on and we're hearing the music from the transmitter being received on this device. And now to give you a true example of just how good the audio quality is of this 900 MHz wireless system within close range, I'll give you a direct hookup sample of an audiophile test montage. And I'll warn you to keep your volume control within close reach because it has a very wide dynamic range. The tape deck is just to use for level meters. It's not actually being recorded to tape.
If you're looking for the ultimate in stereo sound, you've found it. Here's how it works.
Instruments and vocals are placed in their proper staging locations. Stereo imaging is improved and a larger, more true-to-life sound field is created.
The music takes on a new spatial quality. Tone bursts, resonant lows, sizzling highs, and dramatic passages seem to float in midair. And you are center stage, right in the middle of the performance. Listen. We will now pause for several seconds of fine music.
This is the end of the orientation. We hope you've enjoyed getting acquainted with your new premium quality audio system.
I think you'll agree with me, that sounds excellent, but it should when the receiver is right up close to the transmitter. So to give it more of a challenge, I'll go up two flights of stairs to the opposite corner of the house, about 40 feet away in total, through several floors and walls and ceilings. And I'll give you a sample of how it sounds up there. At that distance, there was some background hiss, but you really only notice it during the quietest parts of the music. And keep in mind, that's beyond the normal usable range of Bluetooth, which is commonly cited to be 10 meters, or about 32 feet. And unlike Bluetooth, this is not a one-to-one system. There is no pairing. You can have an unlimited number of receivers, and as long as they're all within range of the signal, they'll pick it up equally well. And likewise, you could set up multiple transmitters at one location operating on different frequencies and then tune them all in on one receiver to provide different choices of what to listen to. Now I'm going to try to pick it up in my Jetta in the garage about 70 feet away from the transmitter. And I normally don't get good Wi-Fi reception in here because those are metal frame cabinets and a metal covered fireproof door behind a metal storm door, all of which tend to block the signal. But the signal makes it through loud and clear with just a little bit of background static. Still perfectly listenable. Now that's impressive. If that background hiss as the signal got weaker reminded you of FM radio, you're exactly right. This 900 MHz wireless system is really nothing more than an ordinary FM stereo modulator and an ordinary FM stereo radio that have been modified to operate on much higher frequencies. And if we view the output of the receiver on a spectrum analyzer, you can see a big spike at 19 kHz. That's the FM multiplex stereo pilot tone. Better quality receivers usually filter this out, but this one obviously doesn't. However, if you're old enough to be interested in and watching this video, you probably can't hear that high anyway. So it's an example of just how good FM radio could sound if the band wasn't so crowded and each station didn't have to compete with 50 other stations for coverage and loudness. So if you want the convenience of wireless speakers or headphones without the digitization and compression of Bluetooth and with about double the usable range, then I think these analog 900 MHz RF systems are a very viable option. And as for what's available today, new analog wireless speakers seem to have almost totally disappeared from the market. The one model I can find by Royal doesn't look very impressive and has a totally bogus 600 watt rating. But new analog 900 MHz wireless headphones are still readily available from major brands like Sony and Sennheiser. Just search for RF wireless headphones and you'll find them.
There's something really magical about waking up for the sunrise to start a hike, and it's become one of my favorite things to do when I travel. When there's no one out yet, except for the mountain goats to greet you in the tunnel as you drive through, the world always feels so untouched and reset, standing still, waiting.